Hello, my name is Deep Saini. I'm the President and Vice Chancellor of Dalhousie University, and you are watching The Deep Dive. In this episode of The Deep Dive, I speak with two of Dalhousie's all-star teachers, Dr. Bob Huish from the International Development Studies Department and Dr. Jennifer Stamm from the Psychology and Neuroscience Department. We speak about how they have responded to the pandemic as well as some of their teaching innovations prior to COVID-19. Joining them is Master of Public Administration candidate Mona Challa. During her time at Dalhousie, Mona took classes with both Dr. Huish and Dr. Stamm. Please join me in welcoming our next guests, Dr. Bob Huish, Dr. Jennifer Stamm, and Ms. Mona Challa. Hello, Mona, Jennifer, and Bob. Welcome to The Deep Dive. It is so nice to have you here. We're going to talk about your experience from two ends of the classroom, the teaching and learning. And so let me get started. And I want to first know something about you, yourselves. Tell me something about yourselves, who you are, and then a little bit more about what brings you to Dal, what it is that attracted you to Dalhousie. So let's start with Mona.
Thank you. Yeah, so I'm currently a second year MPA, so Master of Public Administration student at Dalhousie. I also did my undergraduate studies at Dalhousie as well in the medical sciences program. I did my first year in the Dalhousie Integrated Science Program, otherwise known as DISC. So I was raised in Halifax, Nova Scotia. I moved here when I was four, and I just always saw myself going to school at Dalhousie and then later on integrating myself into the Nova Scotian community and being able to give back. So just kind of saw my entire career track just happening and unraveling in Nova Scotia.
Thank you. And Jennifer?
So I'm a teaching fellow in the Department of Psychology and Neuroscience, and it's kind of special for me because I was in fact an undergraduate in that very same department. My plan initially when I left high school, I wasn't planning on leaving Newfoundland. I was going to go to Memorial. And last minute, I decided, okay, let's try out this Dal thing. And my plan was to go to medical school. I was going to major in chemistry and become a psychiatrist. Thank goodness I did none of those things. So I went off into research and went off to the UK to do my PhD, ended back at Dal, my first postdoc in pharmacology, then my second postdoc in anatomy, and I'm right back where I started. So I think it's, in terms of a cheerleader for Dalhousie, I think my life experience is that.
Well, great to have cheerleaders like you, Jennifer. Bob, let me turn to you.
Yeah, hi, Deep. So I'm Bob Huish, an associate professor in international development studies here at Dalhousie. I'm currently doing research on COVID-19, and I teach a lot of courses on global health. And I've been at Dal for coming up to about 11 years now. And it's been a great place to have many teaching and learning and research adventures along the way. And for someone who likes to try new things with teaching, it's been a great spot to do it. We've done quite a few innovations over the years, teaching courses that involved experiential learning, international study opportunities, and now with online learning. So it's been a great adventure being here in Halifax.
Yeah, and I've had had the joy of experiencing one of your innovations, you know, your podcast. So thank you for doing what you do at Dalhousie. Jennifer, let me begin with you. You know, we're discussing the teaching and learning experience at Dalhousie, particularly during the pandemic. And you and Bob are two of our stellar teachers. You are so focused on student success and engagement and accessibility. And now we have the pandemic, and you have to practice your trade and your passions through this very difficult period of pandemic. Tell me, how has your approach shifted during this pandemic, and how have you maintained your passion for teaching at the same time?
Well, it's been difficult, and I was surprised at how difficult it was for me because I've done a lot of online teaching. Myself and Leanne Stevens developed our first online courses. So I wasn't really scared or apprehensive. And then it happened and there were no people. So that was really difficult. And so one of the things I've tried to do is to have meaningful interactions with students, because online, you can't just hang around. In class, you can hang around and things happen. So I think I'm a bit more mindful of being efficient with my own time, but also my students' time. So I've kind of targeted certain activities to really, really distinct outcomes. Like this is an exam question that I know students have found difficult in the past. So let's hop online. You can't hop online, watch it afterwards, but go through the blank summary table and fill it in. And I'm still learning. I don't know if I have actually shifted very well to an online environment, but it's made me think very differently about what I'm going to do when I go back into the classroom. I'm not really interested in giving an 80-minute monologue anymore. I've got all these videos made now and they're captioned. And so I think I'd like to do a lot more active learning. And the students have a lot of really good ideas. So I just steal them. That's what I've basically done over the last year. A student says, oh, well, why don't we do this, Dr. Stam? I'm like, yeah, let's do it. You know, if you can't be there at 10 o'clock on Tuesday, make sure you go online. So I'm not sure that, I don't know if I could bring a lot of what I've done in the classroom to online. I'm still learning. And I have to say that, you know, Dalhousie students are the best students, as I always like to say. The students have been great and have really been the source of a lot of the things that I've done.
Yeah, that's great, you know, that we're teaching actually offers you learning opportunities yourself. So this is fantastic. And when you learn from the best students in the country, that's even better. Bob, you know, you are so passionate about your teaching, but this is a period which has required an enormous amount of ingenuity from our instructors to keep the teaching effective. And you've been at the forefront of it. You have very creative approaches, including your very interesting pandemic board game that you use in your teaching. Tell us more about that particular initiative and other creative approaches do you have used for your teaching.
Yeah, thanks, Deep. The pandemic has been, you know, foundational in creating change and in innovation for teaching. And, you know, just as Jennifer mentioned, there's going to be perhaps the reality that we're not going to go back to the way things were, that there won't be a return to the normal. So it's required innovation. And I think that before the pandemic, there was a lot of online learning spaces that were used really as document depositories, kind of serving as the same function that a bulletin board would have in front of a prof's door. You sort of put your notes there, your reading list there, you come get it and leave. But just like what Jennifer said, that there's a sense to try to create community. There's trying to create this engagement in online learning. This is where I came up with the idea of offering Pandemic the course, which was based loosely from the board game, which is right here by Pandemic the Board Game. It's a lot of fun. If you haven't played it yet, I recommend it, and you'll never stop playing it. It's just that much fun. But I learned about this game before the pandemic came about. I was actually working in Fiji in 2019, and I was staying with some board game enthusiasts who were at the University of South Pacific in Suva. So we spent the nights playing board games, and when we cracked out Pandemic, someone who teaches in global health, I thought, holy smokes, there's a lot going on with this game. The big part is that it's not a board game where you're competing with each other. You're competing against a virus. You're trying to keep pandemics from breaking out. And we were playing this, and I thought, there's so many important lessons that are coming from this, especially how groups can work together. You have to collaborate. You have to work in a cooperative manner to play Pandemic. And you're doing it without actually having a complete set of knowledge at your hand. So what I did is I got a hold of Matt Leacock, who designed the game. And I said, you know, Matt, this is a wonderful game, so much fun. Can I use this in an online platform? And he checked it out with Z-Man Games and said, yeah, why don't you take a run at it? Let us know how it goes. I mean, there'd be discussions about using things like board games and further online courses down the road as a core for a simulation. So we adapted it. We had different teams. Mona here was part of that. And the different teams had different, I guess, powers. You know, the medics could do some things that the researchers couldn't do. And then every few days, the clock would tick and a new problem would unfold throughout the course. Okay, there's an outbreak in Bangkok. There's now quarantine in Middle East. And the students would have to adapt to that. And for the some 54 cards, city cards that are in the game, I wrote 54 scenarios that were related to real events that happened during the COVID-19 pandemic. So students also had to think about how they were going to respond to those questions and those scenarios about about the course. So I hope it worked well. I'm sure that Mona can comment on that. But the idea was to give students a challenge without all the information at hand. And again, they had to work on those core values of teamwork, cooperation, and compassion to get through it, which is exactly how public health officials have been getting through this pandemic. The places that have fared the best are the ones that have worked together, not having all the pieces on the table, and just trying their best to get to that end goal.
What a fantastic example of innovation in a time of crisis. Yeah, that's really great. Mona, let me turn to you. You have two fantastic teachers here, and you've had the fortune of being a student of both of them. That's quite interesting. Tell me, how in your experiences, these innovative approaches that we are discussing, how these approaches have impacted your experience in the classroom and probably even beyond, and how is that helping your journey through your degrees at Dalhousie?
Yeah, absolutely. So as you mentioned, I have taken courses with both Dr. Stamp and Dr. Huish, both remarkable professors. Their teaching style was very much so hands-on is what I found. So when I would learn new concepts or just new information in the classroom, they really linked it back to kind of almost like an emotional aspect. So it really stuck with me. And I mean, Dr. Stamp could probably speak to this, but if you link emotions to something you're learning, then it tends to stick with you a little bit better. Something we learned in psych. So that was something I really found that Dr. Stamp and Dr. Huish really did in their courses. In fact, Dr. Huish's class was probably the class that led me to pursue a master's in public administration, because my entire life has been I want to go into the medical field. That's where I see myself. But then in my fourth year of medical sciences program, I really understood that there was a lot more to healthcare than pure medicine. There's a lot more of a humanitarian aspect, more like ethics or sociology that really goes into it. And I wanted to understand the policy side of things. Like, why do we follow the healthcare system the way that we do? Which is why I took the master's of public administration. And in that, I again got to take a course with Dr. Huish, the pandemic simulation that we were just talking about. And it was really interesting. As an extroverted student that really likes to stay engaged with my classmates, this course gave me the opportunity to do that. Yeah, so overall, I really enjoyed that course. I would say that I learned a lot from it. We even learned how to collaborate via a virtual environment, hosting meetings with the entire class or assigning delegates from each team to meet at certain times. We created timelines. We were really on top of it. And I think we've all gained quite a number of skills that I can translate into my career after I graduate from the master's degree. So overall, I think both professors kind of use a very interactive teaching style, which really sticks to the students, or at least it's really stuck with me. And I really appreciate that. Thank you.
That's great, yeah. So coming to those two teachers who are transforming students like Mona, we talked about a couple of things, creative things you've done in the classroom, but you've done many creative things. Jennifer, you are an award-winning teacher. You won awards for teaching style and your impact on students. And Bob, you as well. Very very creative teacher. So you obviously you're using other creative approaches in the classroom too. So I kind of focused on one of those two areas, but I'd like you to take maybe a minute or so to tell us a bit more about more broader approaches that you use in the classroom. Perhaps we can start with Jennifer again.
Okay, I'll start. So I think probably, I don't really know what my teaching style is. I started a book club, a science book club. Mona, if you want to join, or anyone. And yesterday I asked the students, I said, I'm going to be on this podcast tomorrow. What's my teaching style? And it's funny because they said the same thing, that you listen to us and you're interactive. So I don't know what other people are doing. But I think the kind of guiding principle behind the way that I approach teaching is that you don't have to be boring. And I get bored with stuff. And neuroscience, I call myself a nerdoscientist, is so interesting that it's not really difficult to get excited about it. At least I don't teach anything I'm not excited about. And I think that's probably the number one kind of guiding principle, is that don't be boring. And I tell you, online has really, really highlighted that all the boring bits can go, especially if they're not necessary. I think the other thing too is that if you give students the tools, carefully selected tools, and it's interesting what you say about, you know, the online being a repository dump. If you give students, you know, evidence-based, carefully selected tools that they can use to succeed and remove barriers, they do all sorts of things. One of my pet peeves as well, and I'll throw this in there, is millennial bashing. We have a word for millennials now. Oh, millennials are entitled, and they're not entitled, they're advocates. And students will approach me about something that's happened and say, you know, Dr. Stamp, have you thought about doing it this way? And quite often, they have got a really good point. So I steal students' ideas, I do it all the time. And it's been really, really, it's been really fruitful. At least in terms of access, one of the things that I think has been really monumental that's going to carry off into the future is our open access textbook that we've devised for intro psych. And we've embedded our videos we've been working on for years, and students can give feedback and we can make changes immediately. We don't have to wait for a publisher. So that wasn't a pandemic plan, but it's allowed us to have a conversation with students about the tools that they're using. And we've already made changes. So that's been really exciting. And this is going to be like that forever, right? I'm actually really excited to go back because we've got this free tool that's open to anyone that, you know, students can contribute to. And I get goosebumps thinking about it, actually. So I don't know what my approaches are, but if there's an interesting idea, then I'll try it. And the worst thing that can happen, it might be a bit of a flop. But for instance, I do a neuron art battle, I call it, because I found that students are having difficulty with the anatomy, and the best way to learn anatomy is to draw. If you can't draw, and I can't, it's a bit discouraging. So I did a contest, and the winner, I called it a battle, but it's a contest. And the winner, it was a $10 Subway gift certificate. The students went crazy for it. But so we continued that online. And I don't know if students are learning the anatomy any better, but it's certainly a lot more memorable. And to Mona's point, if you're emotionally invested in it, even if somebody draws a terrible one, those are oftentimes the funniest ones. They had the concepts right, but it was like a little stick neuron. So those types of things I'm willing to try. And if the students like it, then I keep it.
Thanks. And Bob?
Yeah, so one of the other tools that I've tried to work on the last couple of years was even before the pandemic, and that was podcast learning. A few years ago, I took on the summer courses in international development, and I really had no idea about where to go with online learning, and I sort of asked around a few spots, and they said, well, here's all the tools and things that you can do on Brightspace. And I talked to some people who have taken previous courses, and they said, you know, it's actually really intensive because you have a screen here, you've got a chat there, you got the slides here, something else is over here, your phone's going off, it's distracting, and it takes a lot of energy. And so I kept sort of chatting about that problem, saying, I'm getting into this, I think it was the summer of 2019. And how do we make this a bit more enjoyable? So I chatted with somebody who is actually a radio broadcaster. And she said, well, think about where students are gonna be consuming this knowledge. They're probably gonna be at home, they're probably gonna be on a laptop, and they're probably gonna be folded up on a very uncomfortable IKEA couch, right? So to try to create these dynamic presentations that you can do in a lecture hall or really personal seminars, maybe that won't work so well. And a friend of mine who's in the broadcasting industry, she said, you know, it's radio that people consume best when they're isolated, right? We're used to that. We've been doing that for a century of just hearing stories and voices come at us. So I said, well, why don't we take these lectures and make it into proper podcasting format? And from there, we can use this as sort of a core, and we'll have different types. We'll have ones where, I'll go through the nuts and bolts of what a development theory is about. And then we'll have somebody come in and be an expert, someone who wrote a chapter in the book, for example, and we'll chat back and forth to go over what the meaning of those terms are, like a conversation. And then we'll bring somebody else in who's a research expert who can speak about that, what's going on in the world. And then it will be something that goes at people's own pace. So to put those together, I figured, all right, I'm gonna ask around again for more advice on this, but it wasn't necessarily within, you know, another gang of profs, and you know, got some student feedback to figure out what wasn't working, but to figure out how to use the audio setting, I called up my broadcast journalist friend to figure out how to handle cameras and screen performance. I got a hold of a friend who is a video journalist, and she gave some tips to say, okay, we need to demonstrate something online. How do you do it? How can you demonstrate to perform an actual task? Well, fortunately, a friend of mine is a cooking show host. So I called him up and I said, well, Ben, how can you teach people to cook things in 5 minutes online so easily? He said, well, you do this. And it kept going. And even when it came to the task of being worried about offering quizzes online to make sure that everyone was being genuine in their answers, I talked to my buddy Terrence in Toronto, who runs a pub quiz, a very famous pub quiz in Toronto, and he took it online during the pandemic. So I said, well, Terrence, how did you pull this off? And he said, well, here's all the piece of advice that go with it. So by looking out to find advice from people who aren't necessarily profs, but who do their jobs very, very well, that's been very rewarding. And as a result, this podcast, we've offered it during the pandemic, the podcast courses to some 500 students since July, I guess, is when it started out. But beyond that, we've taken the podcast public as well, quite a few of them. And right now it's on the Global Development Primer podcast, which is available on all platforms. And we've got some over 10,000 listeners who have tuned in 78 countries. And that's the other value added to this, because now we're having conversations with people who can't really be in Halifax, people who aren't necessarily students. We're getting people, coming in from South Africa and Uganda, Fiji, Thailand, all over the world, who are interested in this, and other experts who are coming forward to say, can I offer you my time on your show? I'd really like to chat about these issues. And as a result, it's really taken off. And I hope that it continues, because the most rewarding part of this has actually been to sit down with people and just have conversations about topics that they are passionate about, they're emotional about, they care about it. And then we translate that right into the class to give people good reason to also be excited about these very, very important, topics.
It's an amazing thing, what incredibly diverse number of places you can learn at. And, it's not just simply in the classroom, and you obviously are learning and then passing on that learning to your students. And Jennifer, you had your hand up. Yeah, please go ahead.
Well, it's interesting, and I just thought of this. It's interesting you say about, everything's around the topic. Everybody's really excited to come and talk about things that they're passionate about. I'm a bit intimidated, Bob, because I didn't do any of those things. I'm super low tech. And in fact, we usually test online things on me because I'll break them. But I found that my approach this year, and I think it's worked, I just realized this now, is trying to find topics or questions where somebody can't help but jump in. So I've used discussion boards. They're kind of boring. I don't grade them. I actually use the discussion board as content for the exam. So there's some incentive to participate, but you don't have your conversation graded. That doesn't happen in real life. So I think it's right now has kind of honed in or highlighted what we need to focus on to get people excited about stuff. I learned things in this discussion board, and low tech, I didn't do anything really special. And I think the anonymity has allowed some students to actually benefit from this kind of weird delivery.
Mona, in your case, you haven't only heard about these exciting things, you've actually experienced them in the classroom, and you have experienced them at perhaps one of the most challenging periods in the history of education. Our students have gone through some very difficult time. So from your experience, and I'm going to finish with that, what advice would you give to your peers in enhancing their learning experience in this unusual period?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think the biggest thing is that online learning, you're in an environment where you're all by yourself in most cases. You're not in an environment where a lot of the same people are taking the same courses. And so a lot of the onus and responsibility to keep up with things is just really on you. You don't have those informal conversations to have with your peers to say, oh, is this how you're supposed to do the assignment? Is this how you're supposed to, are these all the deliverables for this course? So there's a lot more self-discipline that goes into online learning. And so when we have professors, check in on us and say, how are you finding this aspect of this course? That's really helpful for us. Because again, like you said, we're the ones that are experiencing the learning. Taking some time off from the screen, since everything is now on screens, is one of the biggest things. If you asked any of my friends, they would think that I could never do that. But I've actually adapted that quite well. And just taking the time away from my screen. And picking up a couple of new hobbies just to keep yourself interested and engaged. Also, don't be afraid to reach out to your professors if you do have questions. I sometimes felt that maybe I was maybe being a little annoying, for lack of better terms, because I would have to ask them multiple questions. But honestly, sometimes a lot of the professors I've reached out to said it's completely fine. Having those discussion boards to post questions so that your peers can also see them is also a great resource to use. So, and last but not least, also like still stay in touch with your classmates, because that is really important. I will FaceTime my friends, we'll have study sessions virtually where we'll just meet each other and just kind of work away on our assignments together, just because it creates that sense of connection. And you don't have to be alone. Like, you can utilize the resources that you have to stay connected. And overall, it's really great for your mental health. So that's what I'd have to say.
Well, thank you, Mona. And thank you, all of you. Thank you, Bob, Jennifer, and Mona. You know, this has been an incredibly challenging period for all of us. And it could have been so much worse, but it actually has turned out that we have accelerated some of our evolutionary processes in the classroom to a speed which is well beyond anything we could have imagined. I mean, we probably have done 10 years worth of learning in 1 year. And you have been at the forefront of it, as you know, and I would say, not only our teachers have been teachers, our students have been teachers as well, and we have collectively learned something new, and that is going to make Dalhousie a better place, Dalhousie a stronger place, and hopefully us better people. So thank you very much for being participants in that, and thank you very much for being at the cutting edge of that participation.
Thank you, Deep. It's been a pleasure.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining me on this episode of The Deep Dive. Please don't forget to like this video, subscribe to the channel, and share this video. Until the next time, I'm Deep Saini, and this has been The Deep Dive.